One of the most common sorts of data analysis that happens in the field of political science is statistical research or numbers-based research. Now, this may sound intimidating to you. It may sound like it's got a bunch of challenges. And in fact, it does include a lot of specialized knowledge. But the good thing is, it's actually fairly easy to understand, and it's got some really good benefits that once you can learn, you'll be able to figure out how to use them. So, together, we're going to have a conversation about why we use statistics and what you can do with them as you're thinking towards your future projects. The first question that I think we need to address is, why does anyone do statistical analysis in the social sciences at all? That may sound like a silly question, but the point is, what is the reason for doing this, right? Why might we want to use numbers and the relationship between numbers to talk about political reality? Well, there are a lot of reasons why. The first is that some information that we want inherently is already in numerical form. The number of people who voted for a given candidate, the gross domestic product per capita of a country per year, the number of people who immigrate from a given place to another place in a year. All of this information already comes to us as numbers. And so if we want to understand it, well, then we need to treat it as numbers, right? Because there isn't another way to think about it, right? You can't do a discourse analysis of a set of statistics. You can do a discourse analysis of the way a set of statistics are presented, but that's another question altogether. So first of all, some of the things we want to talk about basically are numbers already. The other reason you might want to use statistics is when you're in a scenario where you just have tons of data, right? Let's say you collected 1,000 surveys from different people. Well, there's no way you, one person with one brain, can hold the information from 1,000 surveys in your brain at one time, right? At the most basic level, you're gonna sit down and start putting those surveys in piles, right? Well, that, by doing that, you have already started a form of statistical analysis, right? And so when you're dealing with a huge number of different types of data, you have to use a form of analysis that will let you get into all of it. And statistics will let you do that, right? The last reason why you would use statistics is because statistics have a well-known, clear, and well-established logic to them, which is to say there's not a lot of guesswork. If you say, look, I did the math, and it says that this is the relationship, as long as you can prove that's what the math says, then you've made a pretty good claim. This is extremely important for positivists. Remember the notion of positivist causation that we talked about earlier in the class. For positivists, causation means constant conjunction, frequently called correlation, plus temporal priorness, the cause has to have come before the effect, and theoretical plausibility. There has to be a sensible reason why that cause would produce that effect. Well, the only way that you can get a real sense of constant conjunction, of a high level of correlation between these events, is through statistical analysis, in particular through forms of measures of association, right? So that matters for how we think about analysis, right? So if you're a positivist, the form of information about causation that you can get from statistics is stronger than any other form you can have. And because of the strong bias towards positivism within political science as a field, that's why it's become so important for political scientists to be able to do statistical work. So one of the questions you may have is, what kind of data can I work with if I'm going to do a quantitative or statistical analysis? Well, the answer is, you can work with most kinds of data, right? You can work with data from a bunch of different perspectives, and you can get that data from a bunch of different places. So let's think about text, people, and community, right? Our frames that we've used for the other modules, right? Well, texts, you can absolutely use in a quantitative statistical way, right? You can look for the frequency of certain words. You can look for the association between different words. You can look for types of phrases that appear in different orders, right? There's lots of content analysis you can do that ends up being a form of quantitative research, right? So that's one thing. You can also use textual information about the world to construct a database. Do you remember the story I told you about the data set that I helped build based on news stories of contestation events from the Middle East, right? I was working with text, but then I converted that text into numbers. And I had a lot of moments where I was like, okay, is this a 2 or a 3? Right? And then I had to decide, was it a 2 or a 3? And I had to justify my choice. But then once I'd done that, the people who were using the database were able to analyze it using statistics, right? Think about working with people. If you do a survey, you often collect enough data that you have to analyze it statistically, right? There's no other way to do it. And because you've used closed questions usually on a survey, that means you already have categories that can easily convert into a type of a database, right? So you'll use that in order to better understand your data, right? Or if you're doing interviews, right, what you can do is analyze those interviews like text, right? Run them through a content analysis software once you have transcripts. Or what you can do with them is to go through and essentially code them and turn them into numbers, right? To say, okay, number of people who mentioned this idea, number of people who said this was their priority, right? And if you have questions that allow you to do that, you can convert survey data into, or interview data, excuse me, into a data set that can be statistically analyzed. Again, remember, you need larger numbers of participants and more case studies to do statistical analysis, but sometimes you can move between the realms like that, right? There's also, it's very true that you can use existing databases, right? So it may be that somebody has already collected data on a question that interests you, another researcher or somebody else. It may be that the government has data that you want. It may be that organizations you're working with have data that you want, right? All of these things can be sources where you can take this information and use it to analyze it statistically. One of the activities I'm going to ask you guys to do during this unit is to go to the ICPSR, the Inter-University Consortium on Political and Social Research, which maintains a large database of research data that can be reused in statistical format. And that'll give you a better sense of what sort of data there is in the world. No matter what sort of data you want to collect, you can usually find a way to analyze a portion of it statistically. The difference is if you're using a strong interpretivist framework in your data collection, often there are going to be things in your data that you don't feel can be reduced to numbers. And that's okay. Sometimes there might be things that you can use numerically to get information. I, for instance, despite being an interpretivist, like using census statistics and doing some kind of correlations to help understand them, because I think that gives me a bigger picture than I can get merely through the participant observation I do, right? But some data doesn't convert to numbers easily, and that's the sort of data that it makes sense to keep and use in a qualitative format. Essentially, there are three types of statistics that matter for you in this class. Really, there are three types of statistics, full stop, but it's okay. We're just going to lean on these for right now, right? The first type is descriptive, the second type is bivariate, and the third type is multivariate. Descriptive statistics are kind of what it says on the tin. They describe something. You remember primary school when you used to like have to figure out how to calculate the mean and you had to explain what the difference between the mean, the median, and the mode was? Okay, that's the most basic descriptive statistic any of us ever work with, right? A descriptive statistic looks at a whole body of data and gives us a piece of information about it, right? The most common ones that we work with are the mean or the median. We use both of those in different places. And then also we use the standard deviation, which is an idea of how big the spread of a given data set is, right? And how those points are distributed along a line. And so that gives you the idea of what a data set looks like, right? Those are the most important. Descriptive statistics matter, and you can do useful things with them, but what political scientists do mostly is we look at measures of association, how variables interact with each other. And those come in bivariate and multivariate forms. Bivariate, two variables. Multivariate, more than two variables. It's very straightforward here, right? In a bivariate model, what you're looking to see is how is this variable connected to this variable? Do they co-vary, both raising at the same time? Do they relate to each other? Does one cause the raising of the other? Does one cause the lowering of the other? Or do they have no relationship? And I'm describing linear relationships, and somebody in the class who's an econ major is going to know more about statistics than me and want to talk about linear curves. And I will let you do that because I lose the plot somewhere around there. But so the whole point that you have when you have a bivariate association is you want to see is one thing associated with another, right? So a very simple one, right? When it rains, do more people carry umbrellas, right? So you go out on days when it rains, you count how many people have umbrellas. On days when it doesn't rain, you count how many people have umbrellas. You may discover that you've categorized your variables wrong, right? So you may need to go back and say, okay, on days when it precipitates, do people carry umbrellas? Do you need to have a third category, snowing, right? And that's still a bivariate analysis because you're saying type of precipitation or amount of precipitation, right? Those sorts of things you can do as a bivariate analysis against umbrellas, right? Or to bring it back to political science, when it rains, do people turn out to vote in lower numbers? And in fact, the answer is yes, adverse weather conditions lead to lower turnout. This is a fairly simple bivariate correlation, right? So it's a general, in this way, you can just say, how does X influence Y? Or vice versa, normally X influences Y. Okay, the third type is multivariate. Multivariate statistics are really important because here's what we know. Nothing in this world just has one cause. Yes, when it rains, people are less likely to turn out to vote. People are also less likely to turn out to vote in off-year elections, right, when they're less important. They're less likely to turn out to vote if they don't like the candidates, right? They're less likely to turn out to vote if they belong to certain marginalized communities that have been historically excluded from the franchise, right? All of these things are true. And so you can't say if it rained in an area that was majority-minority having an off-year election, which one of those caused the low turnout? Well, one of the ways you can look at that is you can do something called holding things constant, right? You can say, all right, we know there's an effect of this. We know there's an effect of that. If we held those things constant, was there an effect of the thing we're looking at, right? Or you can say, do these things interact, right? In a community with poor public transit, does bad weather have a greater effect than in a community with good public transit or high single car ownership? Right? You can imagine if you need to walk or take two buses to get to your polling station, you might be much less likely to vote in the rain than if you own your own car. Right? So that could be a factor in what's happening there. Right? So in multivariate analysis, you're trying to see which of these variables has effects and which effects matter. Why do descriptive statistics matter for bivariate and multivariate analysis? Because often the numbers that you put into that bivariate or multivariate analysis are descriptive statistics about some part of your data set, right? So if you look at the equations, which you should do, don't be scared, equations are fine. If you look at the equations, you'll see that many of the components of the equations for bivariate or multivariate relationships involve statistics about the descriptive statistics, right? They feed directly into it. So you need to have a thorough understanding of how descriptive statistics work in order to understand bivariate and multivariate analyses and set them up. But fundamentally, it's a matter of just understanding what type of analysis you're going to do and making sure you pick the right test to answer your question. Our culture has a great deal of anxiety around mathematics. This does not make a lot of sense, but it's absolutely true. Many of us are raised to think that math is something that only certain people are good at, right? And many of us, because we haven't always understood what we're doing in math class, because we weren't always well taught, or because we didn't have an instinct for it, have internalized, I'm bad at math, right? And what that means for a lot of people is that when they start hearing about and learning about statistics and about quantitative methods in the social sciences, they say, what? I became a political science major to never have to do math again. Why do I have to do this? Why do I need to know anything about math? I'm bad at math. This is terrible. I want you to stop thinking that way, right? Stop it right now, the end. Here is why. First off, there's actually not a lot of math in quantitative research methods. I mean, there is a lot of math, but you don't do it. The computer does it. Why do we ask you to learn all of this math if you're not going to be the one to do it? Because what you need to understand is the logic of how it works, right? You need to understand what a standard deviation is in order to help understand how a t-test works. These are words you'll learn about in the units you'll do for the next class, right? You need to understand something about how things are calculated so you can get the logic of why a certain sampling procedure works. All of this you need to understand in order to be able to then ask a computer to do the math for you, right? Why do computers do the math for you? They do the math for you because there are too many numbers involved and because they can do it much faster. Computers are really good at doing math very quickly. They are very stupid at drawing conclusions. That's the part you do in statistical analysis. And human beings are excellent at drawing conclusions, right? Quantitative methods are not about math. What they're about is logic. It's about orderly thinking and understanding relationships between things. If you don't set up your relationships between questions correctly, then it's not going to make sense and it's going to fall apart. Well, orderly thinking is about what all social science research is about. It's about thinking together. It's about organizing what you're doing. It's about having a way to talk about these things and present things in a logical, clear order. Regardless of whether you're using quantitative or qualitative methods, you need to be ordered, logical, and clear in what you're presenting. And that's just the basis of it. Quantitative methods give you a framework in which to do that. In some ways, they're actually easier than the frameworks that we do this in qualitative methods, because the logic is already determined to you. They're also less flexible, they're also less creative, and there's a tons of information they can't get, which is why I'm a qualitative researcher, not a quantitative one, but that doesn't mean that this isn't available to all of us. What you need to do, first of all, at this stage in your scholarly career, what you need to be able to do is read statistics and understand them. When someone assigns you a quantitative text in your class, you need to be able to understand it. Those of you who did a difficult quantitative article for your paper at the beginning of the class, you'll remember how difficult it was to understand what was happening there. But if you slowed down and read it carefully, you would be able to understand the assumptions there. That's what you need to be able to do. You also need to feel prepared that you can take the quantitative methods course in the next year and say, all right, I'm going to be able to figure out how this works. I'm going to be able to think in an orderly, logical manner and follow this set of steps. Yes, it's complicated, and yes, it involves thinking in a way you haven't before. But statistical analysis and quantitative research methods are open to you. They provide routes to finding certain answers about certain things, and sometimes they're the only way that you can answer some questions. Don't be afraid of them. Learn to use them and learn to read them. It'll really pay off in the long run.